Good evening, everyone. Thank you for inviting me to this session again. And also thank you for taking your time to attend the same. Today, a session, what I'm going to present is I'm going to take you through the blueprint on how ZeroTap achieved GDPR compliance. And compliance has been one of the core values of ZeroTap, given we are handling telecom data. And when the GDPR regulations kicked in, we saw it as a big opportunity for us to showcase evidence of the same. We took a product approach to the whole problem, which treats compliance as a first-class citizen across all its layers. And my talk today is more leaning towards the product and tech aspects of things, not on the cybersecurity controls and compliance process aspects. So with that, let me start sharing my screen. So let's start. This time a formal introduction, because last week I didn't do that much. My name is Satish KS. I head the engineering here in ZeroTap, and my responsibilities include all the engineering delivery strategy, as well as aspects of technical architecture. I come with around 18 years of experience in IT and have been fortunate to spend last 8 years in the big data stacks. And I'm passionate about the tech evolution from both business as well as the core tech perspective. Another thing I thought I would mention in this forum is I'm also passionate about my art, Tai Chi. Okay, that is my LinkedIn profile. And introduction about ZeroTap. ZeroTap, we are a Berlin-based startup. We started in 2015. 2014 was this thing, but operation started in 2015. And we are a customer intelligence platform which enables brands to better understand their customers. So how we do it is we provide three items. We provide a 360 view of the customer data. We provide identity resolution. And in ad tech, there is a jargon called activation. We also enable activation. So this is a SaaS plus DaaS offering. We were originally a data as a service company because we were only dealing with third-party data. But given the tech stack we built, we also repurposed it for a SaaS style of offering where brands can directly manage their first party data and optionally use the third party data as well for further enrichments. And every data company has a theme. We are people-centric data collectors, and the data can be categorized broadly as the identity data assets and profile data assets. And another style of categorization is deterministic, what actually we collect based on deterministic identifiers. And second thing is, based on our patented algorithms inside the company, we do some inferences and derivations. These we stamp it as probabilistic data, which we supply for our customers as well. And as I told, we are fully privacy and GDPR compliant. We cater to close to 150 data partners, both inbound ingress as well as egress. Currently, the main stacks we are integrated with in any company on any layer is the ad tech layer and the martech layer. So that's about ZeroTap. And GDPR, by now, it is no more tribal knowledge. Given the PDP bill and everything, everybody is having a good level of awareness or a decent level of awareness. But still, I just jotted down a couple of points based on our early memories, because this is a two-year-old law. It is a EU Data Protection and Privacy Bill. It became enforced in May 25th, 2018. And when it came, it had an effect across the whole organization, be it the business teams, the data sourcing team, product and engineering, legal, as well as the security and IT team. Every team had some impact because of this law coming into play in Europe. A couple of broad things it talks about is, one is the personal data. When we talk about personal data, it means the data collected about any person which is identifiable to him, and he is also a EU citizen. So that is called as the personal data. Second thing is the user rights. What are the rights the EU citizen has on the data which is collected by any organization? And what are the access rights? Access right is both from the user perspective as well as the internal organization perspective. What are the access rights and security controls to be there? And it has some recommendations, broad level recommendations. It doesn't go to saying that this is the encryption algorithm you have to use or this is the technology you have to use, but it broadly recommends how you want to handle your data, how you want to transport your data, how you want to store your data. These kind of recommendations are given. And of course, there are audit requirements. With any compliance, any law, and any regulation, there are always audit requirements. And the scariest of all, it carried heavy penalties, which could be a make or break for a startup. If you're not compliant, you can as well shut your shop and go away. So that is the kind of penalties it had. And it had two categories of companies which were handling data. And ZeroTap fell into both categories. We were both a data processor as well as a data controller. We became a data controller because internally we were stitching the device IDs of the person's user with the profile. It may not be directly stitched together, but we had the inference mechanism, and that is one of our patents which we had of how the telecom identities are stitched together to the profile of a person. So by that means, we also became a data controller, and we had to be compliant on both angles. Moving on, as I told you, we took a productish approach. So whenever these kind of regulations come in, first thing you will get from your security and compliance team is a huge Excel sheet, which will ask you to categorize all the data sets, put everything in picture and all these things. Don't fall into that trap. Building a product is sometimes much faster again than doing this operational exercise. And that's exactly what we did in ZeroTap. So when we distilled, when we read through the GDPR from the legal lens as well as the business lens and the product lens, what we did is we distilled it into a bunch of product requirements. And that is what I have listed here. So one of the prime requirement of GDPR was, how do I handle sensitive data? Sensitive data means data of a person's ethnicity, data of his health, his actual PII information, which I have categorized as another this thing. How do we manage that? So these all come under sensitive data management. And second thing is, it talked about, by default, the consent is like opt-out. You have to be explicit about the consent you are collecting. It shouldn't be like an implicit consent. You take a single consent for everything and you take it as a user consent. Instead of that, it talked about explicit consent management. Then the third thing is, how do you manage PIIs, the personally identify information like IP address, name, email, and phone numbers. Fourth is, how do you manage the user information? What is the product you are going to give out for managing his user information? These are a bunch of rights he has, like rights to be forgotten, rights to be erasure, rights to portability, as well as right to understand what data he has and what are the processing we are doing. And access management, of course, access management, I'm not going to cover that much in detail in this presentation because this was moved totally to the IT and infra folks in terms of putting the access management as per the minimum privileged access policy, whatever is applicable. Then the auditing requirements came in as a product requirements, and a couple of other remaining requirements are like sometimes very specific to the companies. For example, ZeroTap has a use case where we create cohorts from the profile data. That is kind of a segmentation or audience creation from the data. So in this, we have some additional requirements to protect ourselves, saying that, say, a cohort should be of minimum 10K size. Beyond that, don't export the cohort somewhere outside. Okay. And what are the TTLs? Say, for if it's a cookie, what is a TTL I'll apply so that I don't have a very stale cookie still in my system? And if it's a MAID, what is a TTL I'll apply? So these kind of custom requirements, always some companies would be having. So that we also had those requirements. It also came into the product. Then, of course, the PII management, and from security perspective, they'll say, okay, if your data is at rest or if you're transporting data to this thing, use these levels of security. Say you need a layer 4 level security, you need a transport level security, and you also need data encryption. If it is encryption, this is the standards you used to use. So these all kind of rules come from the security teams as well. And of course, when you're becoming compliant, you need to scan through your current existing all data sets. So this one-time requirement pretty much should be applicable to any company for a one-time bootstrap or data cleanup as that is asked. So that also became as a product requirement, which was handled in a pretty much operational manner. After this product was built, we ran it initially on the all data sets, and we kind of created this thing. It became like a test bed, internal test bed, if you think about it, for us to figure out whether what we have built is working fine or not. All right.
So Satish, yes. I didn't understand cohort. These are some derived attributes for every individual. What was the particular issue here?
Well, the thing is, you have this collections created out of any data sets, right? So if you have multiple collections, there is a way you can kind of come back to the original identifier, even if you have pseudonymized or de-identified the person, isn't it? So what we do is the cohort, we put up a threshold saying that if say I'm creating an audience segment of say I have 500 dimensions. It's actually what we have. We have close to 500 to 600 dimensions. Suppose a person is able to run a query putting all these filters and he's able to extract 10 records, or say he's able to extract one record. What happens is that privacy is gone. He's able to take the exact person and the identifier, right? So it is like from SQL language, it's a filter query with a where clause on the columns, but we want to ensure this cohort size, what comes out of it, should be of a minimum size so that it cannot be misused for de-identification purposes by cross-combining with other data. But of course, this is not a machine learned or intelligent threshold we have kept. We have just kept a normal threshold, what we deemed as should be sufficient for us. Does that make sense?
Yes. Understood.
Yeah.
So Satish, is the number of filters the minimum you are putting or the different way?
I'm sorry, your voice didn't come out clearly.
Are you able to hear me now?
Yes.
Yeah, okay. So I'm saying, when you say minimum size, is it a minimum size or the maximum size that you're looking at? You said
minimum.
All 500 dimensions are used.
Will
be able to identify.
No, it is minimum size because when I run the query, I'll get a couple of records, right? So I'll get 100 records or 1,000 records or 10,000 or 1 million records. So if the record size is below that minimum thing, we won't be allowing that.
Oh, okay.
Got it. Yeah.
It's mostly about anonymization
or
preventing or making it harder to reverse engineer. If I know that person is as cohort 1, 3, and 25, I shouldn't be able to apply that filter in SQL and match it to two records. If it is 10,000 records, or as the larger the group, the more safer you are as far as identifying an individual is concerned. That's all.
Yeah, that's exactly the principle. The larger the group, it is difficult to reverse engineer to come back to the original identity of the person. Okay, so moving on. If we kind of split the product into a conceptual model, always compliance acts on a couple of entities, right? You have those entities has to be given the first class citizenship in across their architecture, and that's exactly what we arrived at. So if you look at it, the primary entities are here the user and the data assets themselves. And in terms of processing, you need some kind of compliance processing, which can permeate across all the layers of processing in your system, across all your products as well. Then all these, whatever we are talking about in the previous slide, right? If I want to block a sensitive data, I want to validate a sensitive data, drop it, or if I have to keep a hashing encryption, if I have to validate the hash length, everything becomes a policy or a rule set. So that becomes another first class entity in your product. And another thing based on the previous requirement, which is one is the consent. If it's opt out, you need deletion. Deletion is not simple in really, really large data sets, especially when you're storing across multiple data layers. You might have in GCS buckets, you might have in BigQuery, you might have in some other database. So the whole deletion processor workflow itself needs a focused handling, I would say. Same thing applies to TTL as well. And the top four, which I have mentioned, is the consent, audit, user, as well as the data asset. Okay, so I've just layered it as what are the logical entities here, what are the processing entities here, and what is the rule-based entities here. So based on this, we move ahead and started creating the tech architecture for that. The way I'm going to present the tech architecture is more of a bottom-up approach. So we'll see the various items which we actually put together and finally how they combine to achieve the necessary use cases. Okay. So the first thing, okay, what you need and without which you should be really fearful to call yourself compliant is a clean data inventory and a data catalog and a lineage system as well. Lineage is something a bit specific for Zyotac. We had a use case even before compliance to have lineage. I'll just explain it. So you need to know who's giving your data. which partner is giving, what is the region it is coming from, what are the categories of data, whether he's giving me only identity information, whether he's giving me apps data, or he's giving me interest-based data, or he's giving me URL browsing data. So all these has to be there. The categorization has to be there. Then you also need to be aware of what this data contains. What is the schema, or registered schema of a data partner? What are the field types, whether it's numeric or text or string, or it is like some regex? Then what is the cardinality? A zip code could be a very high cardinality item, whereas the age could be can be bucketed and created into a 5 cardinality or 4 cardinality item, as well as gender could be just 3 cardinalities, right? And what are the expected values or expected rejects and all these things? So this is another primary thing you need. And how do you describe the data? Whether it is a raw data set, you have inferred it, it is derived by yourself, if you have derived, how it is derived, okay? Then next thing is, what is a version? Always, when the data is flowing from system to system, right? Downstream system might be acting on a completely different version from what the upstream system is currently handling. So this is something the whole data flow should be aware of. What is the version in that time point, what it is acting upon? So the version and timestamp of the data set is very important. Then the last point is talking about the lineage. Why we needed lineages? As I mentioned, we collect data from multiple third-party sources, right? So suppose there is a user data, his interest data is coming from one data partner, and say his income data is coming from another data partner. How do we attribute that? That means I need to know at each attribute level which data partner has contributed to that knowledge of that attribute, right? So this is something which we have and which came in handy when we had to do the opt-out management downstream as well, okay? Then the second thing is, another important thing is resolution of conflict. I can have partner A saying this particular entity is of age 20, whereas another data partner can say this particular entity is of age 70, right? 20 is compliant, 17 is a minor. I cannot technically hold the data. So what do I do? So I use this to give benefit of doubt to compliance and say, okay, I won't even process this entity. Let me drop the whole record because I'm in doubt. And this has other implications as well. There is a whole layer of data quality and I would say a patented goal set, which kind of helps me in resolving the conflict, but it is kind of a priority queue. If you look at it, compliance takes the highest priority, then the quality takes the next priority, and so on and so forth. Okay. So these are a couple of items which we had to build, which some were built and some we were building at that time to achieve this. This is built over RDBMS and Elasticsearch stack, and it has a microservice and library support. Library support is mainly for the Spark processing aspects. You'll see these two points repeating again and again, the microservice and library support. And when the catalog is updated as during the, say, when a data partner comes in, when his data set's getting onboarded, is there any problem with my voice?
No, it's not good.
Clearly, right? Okay. When it is onboarding, as well as during the processing, right? When the data process is happening across the layers, you have some updates happening to the catalog as well. Like the classic thing is the data point, the knowledge attribution, which is the outcome of the processing. Now, when we were building this I'm talking about end 2017 and early 2018, there were no cloud-based native tools or tools like Apache Atlas, which can provide you this capability pretty much out of the box. Now, we also looking at using any of the specialist tool set and migrate to it so that the management and downstream involvement is much easier on all these aspects, right? And this has evolved to accommodate more items as well, like the quality stacks and verifications as well. So this is the first bit of technology in the whole architecture which was built. Any questions there? Okay, we'll do one thing. We'll take the questions in the end. Let me run through the slides.
Okay.
Does that make sense?
Okay, sure, Satish.
Yeah, okay. Yeah. Probably we can note the questions and take it in the end. Okay, the second entity is the policy management itself. Now, the policy is nothing but rule. If, say, for this data partner, the schema, this is the registered schema. If more schema is coming, raise alert. if the email is not coming in hashed format, hash length is less than 42, then it is not a SHA for SHA hash, drop that record or raise alert to the data sourcing team. So these kind of things. So it's a combo of two things. One is the actual rules and another is the actions. Actions, we have a out of the box set of actions, as well as it is extensible to create custom actions as well. Drop action, alert action, null actions, and all these things. I'll just take you through some examples in the next slides to help understand this. Okay. And this also has a hierarchical support in terms of the policy. If this policy is there, then this also has to be applied, kind of hierarchical support is also there. And again, it comes with the same kind of tech stack, which I told in the previous slide decks. One additional thing is, if you think about it, the policies and actions are not defined by the engineers. It is defined by the domain experts. So we need to give CRUD or create, read, update, and delete via APIs to power users. They could be your legal team, there could be your account management team, or that could be even your product team. So this is one additional thing over and above the catalog, which is being added. Catalog is more or less, it's like a self-info thing. Okay, fine. I've just put a sample of flattened sample of how the policy table is going to look like in the RDBMS. Elasticsearch I couldn't take out because it was coming out a bit bigger than what I expected. Okay, now next thing you need to understand this concept a bit more. This has two use cases. Okay, one is I am separating the actual runtime parameters for the rules and the thresholds for the rules from the actual rule itself. This gives me, say tomorrow for CCPA, if I have to change a different set of parameters for the runtime, I can put it against the CCPA loss. Say for PEDP, tomorrow something else is the threshold and runtime parameters, I can change it. So it is, in database parlance, this is called the normalization, which helps in more flexibility and evolutionary control as well. So what happens is, this is a classic equation. The function of policy plus the function of the parameters which the compliance catalog provides gives you the action. So let's take two actions, for example. Suppose, say, the policy is a schema policy and it is talking about age, and the parameter age threshold is 18, then the action executed is drop the record. Drop action is executed. There is another policy saying that device IP address policy, if it is present in this data partner, that is a parameter. If it is present, it's just a Boolean parameter. It is present or absent. Present means replace it with null. You take the null action on top of it. Another major flexibility which we had because of separating this catalog is the data layer pretty much has many encoded parameters. When I say encoded parameters, the interest, for example, since we are in catering to ad tech and many ad tech data partners are there for us, they give interest in the IAB style coding, which is IAB_1, IAB_2, IAB_3. Like this, you could have custom jargons coming into your data platform. But that may not make sense for your backend as well as the Unity user team. So you need to have some translation. So this catalog helps, though I have named it as a compliance catalog, it is a little broader than the compliance catalog. So it has this blacklist, whitelist, and all these translations so that the backend and UI can consume it as well. Yeah, makes sense. So these two slides, from these three slides, let's see how a Spark processing pipeline is going to work like. Now, if you look at it, whatever I talked about till these three slides, they all fall under, in some way, your data governance layer. I have a couple of other services which I have put here. I'll just take a couple of seconds to explain that. Config service is nothing but the actual Spark job properties and Spark config itself. Because for each of the workflow, each of the item which is being processed, it needs a separate set of properties. Those all are maintained by the config service. And the data catalog, we just talked about. Then the policy store, we just talked about. And path catalog is something interesting. This is for our trigger-based mechanisms. So we, just to give you the problem statement there, all my data partners, they just put data into various GCP paths, GCS paths, okay, the cloud buckets. And this path catalog is actually tracking them, and it helps us in triggering the workflow at the right times. So And once that workflow is triggered, it also knows next workflow as being triggered and registered as a path which is available. So it is kind of a metadata on the pipeline itself. So that is a path catalog. Then last one is the compliance catalog, which we again talked about. What is happening here? Say you have a data partner, you have a data set of the data partner coming in. First, using the governance mechanism, it will figure out what are the schema level policy. It will do the processing. It will take the actions and write the relevant audit logs. Then it will go into a loop where it will look into the value level policies. Value level policies, if you think about it, it has to be applied on record level or the row level. So for each record, it will look at the value level policies and take the actions. After that is done, you get a compliant data set. Okay, so this is how all these three together is getting actuated into an actual workflow. So like this, we have multiple pipelines, but what I'm trying to say is I'm just saying the sample of how one Spark process is going to work here. Okay.
Just one detailed question here. The Spark logs you pull from the individual containers and post-process.
Yeah, into Yarn. So it goes into the Yarn logs, and there is much more nuances there. There is a kind of a pre-process, core process, and a post-process as well. And we have achieved a level of at least once collection of the logs. So that is the way it is done. So from the Spark, it goes to the Yarn logs. We route it into that. And from there, there is a agents running which will put it into Kafka. Okay, next comes the privacy opt-out and consent. So opt-out means the user is saying, just take me out of your system. And there are nuanced opt-out as well as nuanced consent. You can opt-out, and there is something called what are the purpose you're opting out from. It could be a blanket opt-out or a purpose level opt-out. Same applies for giving consent as well. Blanket consent is given or purpose-driven consent is given. ZeroTap has three modes of collecting consent. Given we are a data controller as well, we are obliged to create a privacy website as well as an app. So that is what I have mentioned as the ZeroTap consent that flows into my API, into my backend system and comes into the pipelines. Second is the data partner. When I say partner, who's giving me data into the system? Now, this is again a multifold mechanism because some data partner gives us a cloud transfer, some gives us a SFTP. So it is similar to ingestion, how I get my opt-out and the consent data. Also, there is a HTTP real-time API where they hit when they are doing some syncing stuff as well. Okay, so all these mechanisms are available for the partner as well as the consumers. And based on how my consent is coming into the system, I have three modes of handling within this. So if it is ZeroTap, it is always global because that is directly coming to you as the user is saying, opt me out of your system, opt me out of ZeroTap. That means I have to go and nuke this guy or nuke this entity across my data sets. And also wherever I have given downstream, I have to notify them to take him out of their systems as well, because I have given the data point. Whereas when it comes to the data partner level, if you remember, I talked about the lineage and all these things, what I'll do is I'll only nuke the knowledge which the data partner has specifically given me, be it the identities. If he has given me email and some profile data, I'll take off those email and those data sets. If he has given me email and a couple of other identifiers and a couple of identifiers alone, I just take all those from my system. Okay. The third is the consumer level. Consumer level is even more interesting. When I say consumer is our channel partners. It could be Google, Facebook, Instagram, and all these fellows. So once the user opt-outs of Google, Google comes and tells me this guy has opt-outed out of my system. When I am sending this process data to him, right? At that time, I have to filter him out. See, this user, still I can send to the other channels because he hasn't opted out of the other channels. But he has opted out of Google. So I have to filter it from the Google system alone. So this is why we have three kinds of handling, the global, partner level, and consumer level. And that is all, again, run via various processes. It's very difficult to put all the process slides here. So I'm just giving you a verbal explanation. Hope that is explaining things. If you have any doubts, ask me after the session. Okay. And what happens is, from this consent, you, I'll show you in the next slide, there is a consent object which is constructed, which has the identities on which the consent has to be applied and what is the purpose of the consent. And the latest development in the past 1 year has been, we also became the TCF compliant. TCF is the Transparency and Consent Framework, which came from something called the International Advertising Bureau Consortium, which helps in managing consent at a blanket level across the cookies and the MAIDs, mobile identifiers, because that is the identities primarily ZeoTap works on. It is the browser cookies and the mobile identifiers. Next. So I just explained. Yes.
How big is the data set? Are we talking billions? Are we talking millions?
Any data set I'm talking about is what I'm operating on is on billions. So just to give you a gist of data, I have close to 30 billion identifiers in my system and 8 to 9 billion profiles. And each the profile, as I told you, the number of columns could go up to 500 to 600 as well. Okay, and it has some internal, I have nested column support as well. So it's kind of, we started as a data company, right? So we have, I would say, grown a heavy data asset and we have to manage that. So I'll probably brief about a couple of tech stacks we are using also down the line. So this is how the consent pipeline looks like. As I told, I'm getting from data partner A, probably the second thing I should have given is a data consumer B and ZeoTap. And what is meant by this ID enrich is, see, if ZeoTap is giving, right? ZeoTap, we can get consent from an email ID, or I can get from a cookie, or I can get from an MAID. So since I have to do a blanket nuke, what I have to do is I have to figure out what all the other IDs that is linked to this particular email ID. First thing is I have to hash the email ID because he is sending me an email to privacy.zeotap.com. I have to convert to hash. Then based on the hash, I have to enrich all the identifiers which are linked to the hash. Then I convert everything to the standard format. And same applies for data partner. What happens is if he gives ID, I have to figure out what are all the IDs which is coming to that data partner, which the data partner has given me in the past. And I have to link them all together and create the consent object and the consent tags. Tags is nothing but the purposes which you're talking about. So you have a yes, no, and if it's yes, no, what are the purposes? And currently for no, we are not supporting granular purposes. For a no, we just go ahead and nuke it because, we just go and nuke it. We are not doing any further processing there. So that is why I mentioned as a deletion is one of the activity. And another is for the processing, whether it can be allowed to processing or not is given by the consent processor library as a Boolean for any of the downstream processing. Okay. So this is about the consent data flow, a sample data flow of how the consent looks like. It's not a sample actually. This is how the production also looks like more or less. Next comes the user management. As I told, since we are a controller, this privacy website and privacy app, how we are managing, right? So the primary key here, as I have been alluding to in the past 15, 20 minutes, is like mainly the MAIDs. By MAIDs, what I mean is the mobile advertising IDs, which is the IDFA for Apple and advertisement ADID for Google. Then you have the cookies, browser-based cookies. You have the email hash, you have the phone hash. These are the four key or four identifiers which ZeoTap collect. We don't collect IP address as of today. We don't collect actual names of the person. We don't collect SSN and other things. So these are all a couple of things in our blacklist which we don't collect. For ZeoTap, these are the identifiers we work with. And we had to create an app. We have to create a mobile app and the website. And they interact to the API, the backend API, which is based out of Java Play framework, something like a Drop Wizard and all these frameworks. And given the size of our data set, we heavily use Blooms so that the identifiers are quickly checked whether it is present or not present. And all the identifiers currently is stored in a DB called Aerospike, which is, a fast transactional OLTP transactional read-write database. So that is being used for all my identifiers for this particular purpose as well. Okay. Okay, the next item, we covered a bunch of the items in the product slide, which I showed, as well as the requirement slides. Next is, which is again very important, is audit. So the audit decision we took is, we'll take the logging itself as the audit. And we take all the logs and store it in buckets so that it can be loaded to OLAP database of your choice. It could be Redshift or BigQuery or Snowflake or plain Hive and Presto. And you do your analytics and analysis. But only key there is, we didn't want to make unstructured log. We wanted a common log across the organization, especially for the GDPR compliance. So we abstracted it out with a compliance logger, the library, as well as a microservice. What happens is, the log grammar includes the items which I have listed there, the violation type, which product is giving me that log, what is the data flow stage, what is the action taken, what is the timestamp of the action when it was taken, what is the timestamp when the violation actually occurred, and a couple of other metadata around the log as well, right? So this service is pretty much used across our layers, so that across Spark as well as the backend layers, and we aggregate the log into a single place. And it is stored on, I don't remember the bucket, I think it's month-wise bucket, because compliance logger is not that heavy compared to, say, application logs. So currently, if I remember, it is month-wise buckets. And this can be loaded and you can analyze what all has actions happened and what has how many consents has come in and all these kind of things. You can do some basic analysis and forecasting. Yeah. Okay, putting it all together. So as I told, compliance is a first-class citizen. This is a complete compliance service. It provides capabilities over the blacklist management, sensitive data management, the user data services, audit management. The compliance workflow is what is triggering those Spark workflows and determines which layer has to apply what policies and rule sets. And these are my ingestion pipelines on the left-hand side, and these are the egress pipelines. This is the only slide I had before, so which I used to showcase to, say, our outside deck. So I just reused that, and it's a pretty old slide. I didn't rework on it. And if you look at it, on the top layer is the actual apps which ZeroTap provides for the opt-out. And there is a user and the consent API layer, user API layer. And this admin layer is what I talked about for the policies and the catalog management, which is not exposed to this web app. So this admin layer is actually used only by the power users, for the API based users. And it's just a representative from the various stores which we talked about till now to achieve this, the whole use cases, right? So this is how, if you look at it from a 50,000 feet view, how the architecture is going to look like for this, the whole product. Next is any architecture, you'll have a couple of requirements, non-functional requirements, like how it scales, how resilient it is it extensible, and all these things. So this is from our own experience. When we deployed this particular system in place, we had close to 80 workflows. Now we have more than 400 workflows, and we are still scaling on a day-to-day basis. And all workflows has a certain set of process of how this has to be, how this is initiated in the Spark library and how it takes care of the things, right? Second thing is, we also did a AWS to GCP migration, and it was a decent, fairly simple lift and shift for us, this whole compliance angle as well, this process as well. Then second is, when CCPA came into play, we could tweak the policies accordingly for the US and specifically to the CA, California region, to make it extensible and accommodate those aspects as well. Of course, there were some changes. I don't remember everything off my head, but as far as I remember, we could accommodate everything without engineering effort. Just with the testing and sanity effort, we were able to cover that. So this is largely the pipeline summary of how the things have been deployed. Next item is infra and security validations. I thought I'll briefly touch upon this. ZeroTap, all the infra is split region-wide. We are very, very careful about data sovereignty. Whatever data is in EU, it is always in EU. Data storage as well as processing. Same applies for US, and same applies for India as well. And the access rights controls, we have a couple of certifications which I'll touch upon. So it's, as I mentioned in the talk before, it is based on minimum privileged access across all the data sets. And we have a chief data officer as well as a security person who does a quarterly audit on this and figures out if there are any exceptions and passes on recommendations, which is taken up by the infra team. Then we don't mix the ID and profile except during runtime processing. Always the ID and the profile is pseudonymized. In the sense, during ingestion itself, if I get an email ID or a cookie ID, what happens is a pseudonymized ID, which we internally call as a ZU ID or a ZeroTap unique ID, is identified for each of the user profile entity. And at any point in time, if you want to do analysis of, say, general age bucket analysis or general interest bucket analysis, or how much of fill rate I have, you operate on this identifier, which doesn't give the actual identifier of these sets. That is happening only during that access is allowed only for the runtime applications. Then another security recommendation is the data at rest encryption. Pretty much all the data at rest, be it in GCS buckets or anything, it's encrypted. We also use BigQuery, which is again encrypted data at rest. And the email and phone numbers we hash. This has some nuances in the sense we support all three hashes. If a data partner says I can use all three hashes, we go ahead and use MD5, SHA, SHA 256 as well, applied for phone number. And we use uppercase, lowercase, and ignore case. So in all, this hash combination itself is like a 9 + 6 = 15 total combinations are available in our systems. It may not be always the same fill rate because of the contracts we enter into the data partner. So these are all a couple of other items I thought would be useful for this forum. So I presented this as well. And the hash all are validated. We have every hash has a length parameter, so you can easily validate, as well as the email and phone number. There are regexes against which you can validate. So these are all IDs which you can validate, unlike a cookie, which can be any random UUID, right? So whereas these identifiers, which are PIAs, you have some levels of validations as well on top of it. GDPR doesn't recommend any certification out of the box, but if you have all these certifications, it kind of enhances your stance in saying that, okay, we can believe this company is compliant. So we have gone through ISA 27001 certification for past 3 years. We did a recertification this year as well. And same applies for the CSA star certificate from BSI. I don't remember this thing. It's some British Standard Institute or whatever. Then the e-privacy seal from the, I think it is from the EU forum, one of the forum. We also have that. I don't know what will be applicable for the PDP down the line, if there is going to be some other ISO stack or whatever. But yeah, given all the stacks we have built, we are very confident that we could just swim the PDP bill through as well. And current additional developments which are happening is, if you look at it, when I was going through the slides, there were a couple of manual processes which can induce human errors, like when the data partner is onboarded, there could be some manual errors in terms of saying the schema has so and so items, whereas the additional item comes in. Of course, there are some validations present there, but still there are human errors which can creep in. What we are looking at is current development is going on around NLP, AML based scanning of the data sets and application. Of course, there are major cost challenges of productionizing this as well. But this is some active development which is going on in terms of both for the data quality as well as the compliance aspects. This is the current development which is happening in the organization across the data layers. And yeah, that ends my slide show. We can move on to the question and answer sessions. Hopefully there were some useful pointers for everybody and some takeaways. I'll just stop the sharing unless anybody asks for anything. Thank you.
Thanks, Satish. There are actually quite a few questions, so let me try to club some questions together. I think one question, let me start with the most recent question. This is from Tosif. He asks that since you collect data from user browsers directly, how do you deal with unstructured data like password reset tokens, which also get collected and can be used to uniquely identify a customer?
Yeah, so currently we are not collecting passport from the third party perspective. So that is under the first party preview that is under development currently, the authenticated traffic solution. So once that is coming in, we need to, we don't have a current solution to be honest. We are looking at various aspects of how to manage that as well. So yeah, I know this forum is divided between say a first party data collector, like say for example, if you take any of our e-com providers, they are a first party data provider. So being a third party aggregator, we have some contractual clauses saying that I won't take this data from you at all. So that is what is protecting us. But of course, once we venture into the first party data, these are some challenges which we are going to face.
Tausif, if you have a question further, you could either put it in the chat or you can feel free to unmute yourself and ask. I'll move on to the next question, which is slightly related, which is from Naushad. Which is on what does GDPR say about data which is scraped through social media for publicly available posts?
Which is scraped through social media on publicly available?
Post. Naushad, do you want to directly ask your question because it might be open to interpretation also?
Yeah, so if the organization collects the data by scraping the social media post, what is the GDPR stand on that?
Okay, so I'm not sure of the GDPR post, but if you look at it, what you have to do is you have to be, at the end of the day, you are acting as a third-party data collector there. So from GDPR perspective, if you ask my opinion, you have to register yourself as a data processor. And whatever is applicable for the data processor rules, right, you need to adhere to that is what my current take is. But it is better answered by your legal team as well if you're doing this processing. But from first look of things, if you ask me, you become a data processor there and you have to adhere to all the clauses which are pertaining to a data processing.
Also here, one key question to be asked also is how the scraping is happening. Is it with the knowledge of the social media app or is it without the knowledge? Because the moment it is without the knowledge, you are anyway going into the security realm. If it is with the knowledge, then you would have some agreement with the social media app to be able to scrape that data. And there are some logistics around it. I think YouTube, Facebook, everybody has that kind of licensing agreements available for you to be able to scrape it.
Okay, so it has to be done under license from the data controller.
Yes.
But okay, something is publicly available, still one has to go through the licensing route.
So we had to look at this question recently for one of our customers. And when we looked at LinkedIn, there was a lawsuit against scraping LinkedIn without having a formal licensing agreement from LinkedIn. And it has survived through the US courts. And today it is legal to scrape publicly available information from LinkedIn. But they make it extremely hard to do it. I mean, they're almost like quasi-licensing by blocking you very aggressively and things like that. Okay. But it's legal.
Mm-hmm.
Naushad, does that answer your question?
There could be a challenge in identifying the data subjects, whether they are EU residents or outsiders.
Yeah, that is definitely a challenge, Naushad. And that is the first exercise, actually. You have, I would say, a large exercise in identifying your data assets and where it comes from. And these are all questions you need to ask to your tech and product team, or if you have a specialized data sourcing team, them as well. So from a security angle, yeah, this is a valid question from a compliance team angle. But without the answers to the previous questions, right? The data inventory questions, it's very difficult to arrive at what is the action you need to take on those.
Yeah, thanks, Satish.
Okay, so Samir has a question. Samir, can you ask your question directly?
Yeah. Hi, Zadish. So I was looking at, so there is a lot of talk going on around having metadata tagging to the core data to identify them as PII.
Yeah.
Or you build into the system so that the tags or in some way, the data is pre-identified through configuration. So while you were describing the architecture, I did not come out clearly in terms of when you say I can identify or use the data catalog across, were you using a configuration for each data type or were you using any metadata along with it?
So we use configuration as well as metadata. So let me give you an example.
Okay.
Say if the lineage is coming, right? So that is a data partner level tag, which is happening with the data itself. Okay. And if it's a derived attribute or what is the derivation going, that is going as part of additional columns with the same data itself. Okay. Another thing is the actual, what is the other thing? The metadata, right? So we yes. have metadata as well. How do I put it? To just give you an example, say for a data partner, this is a schema which is coming out. So that is coming as a metadata and that is used for enforcing the validation. I'm not sure if I...
Okay. Got no, it. No, I got it. Yes. I got it. Cool. Thanks. Yeah.
Okay, so we have two. Sorry.
Now, actually, you can model all this in a graph database. Now, Atlas is giving that, I would say, abstraction on top of Janus Graph directly. So you can manage both this tag-based use cases as well as database use cases by using it intelligently.
Yeah, that's there. But then what happens is, if you have not tagged all the backdated data, because you would have started configuration at some time, the challenge that a lot of product platforms are struggling with today is the overhaul in the design required to ensure that is enabled before Graph can come in and do something.
Yeah.
Or build an outside config layer, which can then be used as a schema to map across wherever you find the data.
Correct. So this is I would say a one-time activity. It's not even a reusable activity.
Yes.
So, yeah. Unfortunately, we have to go through that one-time activity at least once. And in a way, if you look at it, right, you build all these stacks and you take your data set and run through these, it becomes a test as well for that one-time activity, whether it is
absolutely yes. But that's great when it comes to the structured data. The unstructured is still a different challenge altogether. So data that is already outside the system is sort of becoming a challenge now for everybody.
Correct. Unstructured is always a challenge. Yeah. The easiest way to tame it is have some versioning and stale data. Just take it out of your system or put it in Glacier. Take it.
Yes.
Don't use it for any active processing.
Yeah. So one of the things, somebody was telling us that maybe it'll be easier to simply replace all the machines, not give them any access to prior data and see what they really require, only generate data. So that could be an overhaul that is doable. But then I don't think something like that is feasible. It's just probably a joke that was going on.
Yeah. Okay. Cool, Samir. Yeah, other questions.
So we have two questions I'm going to club together. One is from Rajat, which is about, he says that you partially answered the question, but he still wants to check, do you consider open source projects or are you looking at them now? There are a few popular ones like
Amundsen is from
Lyft. He's interested in gathering your inputs on these projects. And then there is one from Naman, which is about why did ZeroTap move from AWS to GCP? Was it more from cost standpoint or compliance standpoint?
Well, it had nothing to do with compliance per se. It was other business reasons. On Rajat's question, Rajat, we did a POC on the various catalogs available, and within our lens, we saw Atlas to be one of the best out there. because beyond the basic data catalog, right? If you remember, I had given some use case around the path cataloging and other items as well. In ZeroTap, given the number of pipelines, right? We have like 400 plus pipelines. That itself becomes a management issue. So to manage metadata around the things beyond the data's metadata as well, we found Atlas is much more extensible. Amundsen is a very good product. You have to fit it with your use case. I would say run a time box POC. And even cloud providers have started coming out with data catalog. Google just went from beta some 3-4 months back. That is also a decent catalog. You can look at your use cases and cross position. One thing in all these big data systems is always run some kind of use case to your POC to assess whether it is working fine for you. Because everybody will claim I'm doing everything, but it doesn't work that way.
Rajat, your follow-up question, or does this answer your query? Okay, I think Rajat may have bandwidth issues. Venkat, I think you have the rest of the questions, so maybe it's just better if you ask them.
Yeah, I got some of them already. Just one thing that I wanted to ask was, the lineage is at a column level?
Yes, lineage is at a column level. No. Attribute level, sorry.
Attribute level.
Yeah.
Now, when you have new policies or the policies change, what happens to already all the previously computed data sets?
So if you look at it, Venkat, since I have a separation of the identity and profile, okay, my identity is more or less transactional. My profile is more or less snapshots. Okay, it is processed and whatever ZUID is at that point in time is there, it is attached to that. So what happens is, if I nuke the identifiers in a transactional manner, that particular ZUID and that profile is more or less stale for me. And in the subsequent processing, whenever it happens, it automatically dies a natural death. So even though I have that active data in my system for some time, it dies away in the subsequent processing.
Okay, essentially by creating that one level of indirection, you are removing that mapping.
Yes, exactly. And the mapped IDs is transactional. The aggregated as well as the profile things which have the actual data is a snapshot. You get it. That's the way it works.